Welcome, and thank you, fellow investors, for coming and joining us here today. I am Lika Gradic, and behind me I have Cesar Guerrero, Marissa Anzalotti, Alexa Rodriguez, Alexa McAndrew, and Casey Molden. We are the investor consultants in Colombia. We are here today to address why the U.S. should invest in Colombia. We will be talking about the infrastructure, the culture, the demographics, the business relations, the economy, and the government. So if y'all could please turn off your cellular devices and leave your questions to the end, we can get started. So again, I am Lika Gradic, and I am a civil engineer here in Bogotá, and I am going to be talking about the infrastructure. So I'm going to begin talking with the current and the past infrastructure of Colombia, what the plans are currently, and the future of the infrastructure in Colombia. So to begin, according to World Economic Forum, Colombia's infrastructure is one of the worst in Latin America. Now, that is largely due to the fact that Colombia is located within the Andes mountain range, and alongside that, there has been corruption and a shortfall in financing for the infrastructure here in Colombia. Now, with the lack of effective road systems, it has limited Colombia in being able to use its prime location for different business realms, which then leads me into what is Colombia doing about their infrastructure. So, as of last year, they have begun on a new project called the Fourth Generation, or 4G, that is here to implement this new infrastructure for Colombia. Their top priorities in this infrastructure is the roads, the tunnels, and the bridges, because those are the main infrastructures that will allow Colombia to grow as a country and develop more. So as of right now, the blue is the existing roads that are in Colombia. You can tell that it is very spread out. There's not very many connecting from coast to coast and so forth. So according to Financial Times, in 8 years, they expect to have 5,892 kilometers of roads added to Colombia. As you can see right here, to broaden their reach throughout the country so that rural and inner markets are able to reach out to the urban, and them being able to reach out from coast to coast, because Colombia has both the Pacific and the Atlantic on either side of it. And so this thus leads us into the future. So if all goes well, and it's in a very positive light that it will be able to be executed, it should be completed by 2023, and then this would allow Colombia to continue to grow and expand its economy through the different export, imports, and business areas, and allow them to be more competitive with other countries, which they are not competitive right now. So to recap on what I discussed, I talked about the current and the past infrastructure of Colombia, the new 4G plan to develop the infrastructure here in Colombia, and the future plan to help develop and grow Colombia's economy. And so now I will be passing this on to Cesar to discuss the culture.
My name is Cesar Guerrero. I've been doing business in Colombia for 3 years, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the customs and business culture in Colombia. Colombia is a very religious country, with 90% of the population being Roman Catholic and 10% being from other religions. Catholic priests also play a very important role in the community. They are community leaders, and they also help families take important decisions. They're very involved with the community. Also, the official language in Colombia is Spanish, and there's also 500,000 people who speak American Indian languages. Business culture. Business starts with the handshake, and that's very important in Colombia. It's very important to have eye contact with the person you're having the handshake. because this roads this gives you confidence and also it's a sign of respect over the person you're talking to. Also, greetings should be prolonged. You should always have a small conversation with the people so that they remember you and they also start building trust, which is very important in Colombian culture. Also, it's important to hand business cards, and business cards should have one side in English and one side in Spanish. And also, it should include your degree. Colombians are really proud of this, and it's also important to have business. And also, when you call a Colombian, you should always call them by their classificational degree. For example, if they have a PhD, you should call him Doctor and their last name. If they're an architect, Arquitecto and their last name. And if they're an engineer, Ingeniero and their last name. And also, even though there are agendas or meetings often get rescheduled. For example, if you are going to Colombia in 2 weeks and you schedule a meeting, that meeting will most likely get rescheduled. This is something really common over there. Also, Colombians are indirect communicators, meaning that they will talk a lot about with the body language and not with the mouth. You should always like try to read their body language if they're not clear about something. And also, as I said before, trust is very important. If they trust you, they will do business with you. This is the one of the things that they consider the most when they're trying to do business with someone. That's why you should always, as I said before, try to get to know them better. Also, when you're in meetings, they never rush meetings. The meetings will last as long as they have to do, and they will never be rushing them. Attire gets more formal as you get closer to the major cities. What I mean by this is that, for example, if you're doing business in the smaller cities or the rural areas, you will most likely get dressed with a business casual attire. But when you go to the bigger cities like Cali or Bogota, you will use suit and tie. Also, as I said before, punctuality is relaxed. For example, if you have a business meeting scheduled at 3, it will most likely start at 3:30 or 4. That's really common over there. And also, if you're gonna schedule a meeting, you should go for lunchtime, because this dinner time is mostly with family. They like to spend dinner with family. And some good topics to talk about with them are history, soccer, culture, coffee, and gold museum. And some topics to avoid are drug trafficking, politics, and religion. I talked about customs and business culture. Now I'm going to pass it to Marissa and Celori to talk about demographics.
I'm Marissa Ancelotti, and I'm going to talk about Colombia's location, its resources, as well as the demographics, including ethnicity and literacy rates. So Colombia, in terms of natural and human resources, it offers a strategic location, a well-educated workforce, and a well-industrial capacity. It's located at the northern tip of South America, and it has rainforest, mountains, and coffee plantations. It's actually the only, it's in the only country in the region that has both the Pacific and Caribbean coast. It has rugged terrain that's led to develop enormous reservoirs, which has led to the increase in the country's water supply and energy. The subsoil is full of natural resources, for example, being the world's largest open cast coal mine, which has made Colombia the 10th largest coal producer. It's also the second most biodiverse country, which has led to important developments in the fields such as food and medicine. According to the embassy, it is the second largest country in Latin America and experienced rapid population growth in 2002. The birth rate has decreased steadily as a result of increased literacy and urbanization. And these are a few pictures of the more urban areas in Colombia. Per the CIR World Factbook, as of 2015, there are 46.73 million people currently living in Colombia, with a median age of 29 and a population growth rate of 1.04%. The urban population is actually 76.4% of the entire population, with the rate of change where people are becoming more urbanized at 1.66%, and people are moving to major cities such as Bogota, Medellin, Cali, Barranquilla, Bucaramanga, and Cartagena, which is where most business interactions actually take place. So talking about the people who actually live there, it's an ethnically diverse because people who there have descended from original native inhabitants, Spanish colonists, and immigrants from Europe and the Middle East, which all contributes to a diverse cultural heritage. There's 60% mestizo, 20% European, 14% Amerindian, and 5% Afro-Colombian, and 1% Native Indian. And Colombia is home to a thriving middle class, and with a 94.7% of the entire population over the ages of 15 can actually read and write. So to sum up what I said, not only does Colombia have a good location with its natural resources, but is continuing to become more urbanized, but also has hardworking, intelligent, diverse people. Now I'm going to pass it over to Alexa, who's going to talk about the economy.
Hi, I'm Alexa, and I'm an economist at Columbia. My main points for today are going to be, I'm going to talk about the overall economy, the currency, and their main exports. So, development, stability, drive, and overlook are words used by investors in Colombia. For Colombia, according to their gross domestic profit, Colombia is the fourth largest economy in Latin America behind Mexico, Argentina, Brazil, and yeah. The World Bank lists Colombia as an upper middle income country ever since Bogota and Medellin became innovating cities. From 2007 to 2012, Colombia's tech industry grew 177% since Facebook, Microsoft, and Google opened their offices in Bogota, and fiber optic cables were installed in the capital city. Tourism is an important sector of Colombia's economy. The number of tourists in Colombia grows over 12% every year. And because of that, Colombia has created more museums and has restored historical sites. So their currency, Colombia's currency, is the Colombian peso. One US dollar equals around 2,873 pesos. One of the most compelling reasons right now to invest in Colombia is because of their currency exchange compared to the US dollar. Your dollar will buy you more in Colombia right now than in any recent memory. It's a great opportunity for national producers to compete with foreign firms and to grow and provide their products at overall overseas businesses. Domestic goods are cheap in Colombia, which will increase their exportation. So according to Colombia's website, petroleum is the main export in Colombia. It makes 45% of their overall exports. Other well-known export materials from Colombia to the US are crude oil, coal, coffee, and flowers. It is Latin America's largest oil producer, the world's largest coral exporter, and the leading producer for raw emeralds. Modern industries like shipbuilding, construction, automobiles, and mining have increased since 2000 to 2010. Now Colombia is Latin America's second largest producer of domestically made electronics behind Mexico. So in conclusion, I talked about the overall economy, their currency, and their overall exports, and I'll pass it on to Alexa, who's gonna talk about the business relations.
Again, my name is Alexa McAndrew, and I'm a business relations executive. And when considering doing business or investing in Colombia, I thought it was important to look at three main things, that being past conflicts that the US and Colombia have had, any current relations, and then also restrictions. So for the most part, the US and Colombia have a very friendly relationship in it. They've aided each other a lot in economic development. The only time that there's actually been strain in the economy or just any relations was during the Roosevelt administration during the Panama Revolt. However, the strain didn't last long because the US is actually a major market for Colombian exports and then also for revenue with things like so moving into the current relations as we remain strong coming out of past conflicts, Colombia is actually one of the US's most important strategic partners in the Central and South American region. As pulled from foreignaffairs.com, global trade negotiators are actually negotiating new agreements to aid in trade and barriers and any restrictions.
So the International Trade Administration believes that the U.S.-Colombian agreement will actually aid U.S. businesses and also investors and help people like businesses, farmers, ranchers, just any type of average day worker, and actually create jobs in the U.S. And when looking at the total volume of trade between the U.S. and Colombia, it actually continued to climb from 2011 to 2012 by 10%, and they increased by $41 billion. So since I kind of touched on barriers, I want to move into restrictions. There is actually no travel restrictions when going from Colombia to the U.S. or U.S. to Colombia, which is really nice when trying to globally interact and do meetings and kind of just experience both ends of the cultures. All you need is a passport, and there will be like a 10 or a 90-day visa that you would have when you get there. And then going into imports, there's actually three tariff levels, so these different taxes. From export.gov, it says from 0 to 5%, there's a tax on capital, industrial, and raw goods. And then manufactured goods, there's a 10% tax, and there's some exceptions, like if a good comes from another country into the U.S. and then back to Colombia. And then 15 to 20% for consumer and sensitive goods that may come through. But for the most part, these restrictions are very minimal. So to recap what I talked